Everybody, it's a great pleasure to I'm happy to announce our today's speaker, Gordon Pipa, who's visiting us today and tomorrow. If you want to know where he's from, that's always a bit difficult to explain with him because he's usually localized. He's at the moment group leader at the Max-Planck Institute for Brain Research in Frankfurt. He's a research fellow of the Frankfurt Institute of Advanced Studies, not too far away. At the same time, he holds a substitute professor position in neuroinformatics in Osnabrück. And until recently, he could also be found a lot on the plane between Europe and the US, since he was also affiliated with the MIT and the Massachusetts General Hospital. He's at the same time very active in organizing meetings and very a passionate teacher, as I know. Recently, has been last autumn organizing neuroscience meetings together with Claudio, and he's also one of the main organizers of this famous Frankfurt Institute of Advanced Science, Neuroscience and Complex Systems Summer School. Most of all, however, he's a good friend. And collaborating with us in the just started European project Focus on Liquid State Machine. And we're happy to have him here to explain a bit what our project will be about.
So it's kind of coming home, right? So, like, what, 3 years ago, I spent here 3 months. So it's great to be here again. Okay. So, I would like to actually use this image as a starting point. So if you actually talk about neuroscience, then actually what you actually usually read, what people think is going to happen in the brain is that you have actually a lot of noise. So actually the noise is overwhelming if you look to EEG data or also to spiking data. So sometimes it's really hard to believe that actually the brain is doing anything that is reliable. So therefore, actually, some of these statements are, and I just took actually the first sentence of the Bernstein Center webpage as an introduction, and it says, the discrepancy between the reliable performance of the computing brain and the large trial-to-trial variability is of direct clinical and biotechnological interest. And it is, of course, because we have to actually find out a way how the brain is actually doing something that is actually pretty much constant over time, while actually the responses of the underlying complex system is totally different, at least if you measure them. So the question is, you know, what kind of computational devices can handle such a huge variability and do still something which is actually reliable? So I have a different take to it. So if you actually use like EEG, then we essentially measure activity on one level, right? We actually measure activity on a population of, let's say, 10,000 to a million or so neurons. But of course, at the same time, we also have activity on the level of individual neurons. So if we actually look just to one scale, we might get the impression that actually we get a huge variability. But maybe that's just because the information that characterizes the entire system is spread across different scales. Right? So this is actually a talk which tries to elucidate this a little bit, how we can actually read activity from the brain and explain variability if we consider different levels of activity, which are microscopic from single neurons, mesoscopic from, let's say, 10,000 neurons to microscopic activity, which if we measure by EEG. That this is really going to happen, I would like to actually use this image or this movie. So essentially what you see, there are 12 points. But of course, you're not seeing 12 points, right? You're seeing a sportsman doing sport. So the question is, how can you actually see so much information and so little information that is actually presented? And that is, of course, because you have a very detailed model in your brain how somebody looks like if you do sports, right? So you actually directly associate this point, for example, with a hand. But actually the information that I'm giving you is just a moving point. So essentially what's happening in the brain is that you have a very detailed representation of, you know, like body and movement, and you have to connect this very rich representation to the visual information that is coming in into the retina. Then the retina is extracting some information on the level of single neurons, and this information has to be then linked somehow to the information that coming from other areas from the brain that are representing the model about your body that is actually doing the sports. So it's immediately clear that this cannot just happen in your visual cortex, but many different areas on many different scales have to interact. Okay, so I actually splitted this talk into two parts. In the first part, I will tell you something about the principal model, how you actually can explain or may actually be able to explain this multi-scale computation. And this is actually the liquid state machine computing, and that's essentially the main idea of the focus project. And in part two, I try to actually convince you that you, if you assume that this is really going to happen, you can, and you actually use then an approach from just neuroinformatics, you can really learn models that decode information using a multi-scale approach. Okay, so I would like to actually use this movie to illustrate the basic properties of actually liquid state machine computing. So while actually this moving is going on, you will actually be at any moment in time be able to infer what happened in the past and what's going to happen in the future, right? So for example, if you look to these waves that are propagating here, you can easily actually say that these had been caused some time back by a drop falling into the surface. So the question is, what do you need for that? You need first causality. You need that actually these waves that are propagating here are connected to an event in the past. The second thing that you know that you need is you need an internal model, because only if you know how waves are propagating, you can actually make sense of it, right? If you would be exposed just to a still like this, and you would see it the first time, and you have never seen propagating waves, you have no idea what is going to happen, right? So you need an internal model. So why is it a helpful idea to think about actually computations may happen in the brain? Because we can actually map this to actually recurrent networks. So essentially what you have here, we have a perturbation. This is a drop falling into the surface. We have here something which is a complex system, which is like the surface of this water. So what we do is we perturb the activity in this network. And then we need something which is equivalent to the model of propagating waves in your brain. And this, for a very simple case, is just a classification. So essentially what we do is we have a mapping of a certain perturbation to a certain state where we say, okay, that was a drop falling at time t into the basket. That is actually the perturbation. And in between, we have a complex system. And this complex system is doing something. What is it doing? It actually maintains information about the past. In physics, we call it fading memory. So that's all what it is. And it's doing something which is very important in addition. It has a nonlinear mapping of the input signal into a high-dimensional reservoir state. So we have a very simple stimulus here. Let's say it's a time series, one-dimensional time series. We feed that into a recurrent network that is composed, let's say, of 1,000 elements. So in principle, we have 1,000 elements that are dynamic over time. So we actually expand the feature space enormously. And then we use a classifier to contract it again to a one-dimensional signal. So why would we do that? We do that because with this expansion, we increase the likelihood that we have a so-called linearly separable space. So essentially, we use this complex dynamics only for one purpose, which is something like a pre-processing. So we want to actually have a high likelihood that this linear classifier can separate different states. So if you have different perturbations that need to be recognized by the classifier, expanding that in this very large dimensional space, we have a high probability that in any of these many dimensions, the system has actually a different a linear separable space. So it essentially means if you have a hyperplane, you have actually states in one region and another region. You can separate these two states with just a hyperplane. So for people that are familiar with neuroinformatics or machine learning, this is actually what was introduced as a support vector machine in like 20 years back. This is just a dynamic version of a support vector machine. And then, of course, very important, one has to show that actually this mapping is useful. And what means useful? It essentially means that, in principle, you can do any kind of computation with it. So it's said to have universal computational properties. Okay, so it was introduced as an ecostate network by Herbert Jäger, in a liquid state machine by Wolfgang Maas, pretty much at the same time, 2002 and 2003. So how do we model something like that? I present you now 10 slides how we model this. So we have a recurrent network. The topology is represented by a weight matrix. We have a vector here. That's the activation vector. That's the whole thing is an incoming drive to unit I. Then we have an update equation that we have actually state hi at t plus 1. Of course, depends on the state x of t. And we have a threshold. You might wonder why we have an x and an h here. This is because we have a so-called winner-take-all mechanism here. So essentially, we compute the activation function, which is real-valued, and then we take just the k-strongest units to be active. That's a binary response, and this binary response enters here. So essentially, we reduce it to such a case where k is 5. So just 5 neurons are active. And so this is a bias to be active, and you will see later that we assign that to something which we call plasticity. Okay, that's a very simple model. Later, we extended this to be stochastic, and so we did it such that this was not a k-winner-take-all with k fixed, but that we have a thresholding operation here which was stochastic. But restart stayed the same, so therefore I explained the simple thing. Okay, so the basic idea was that actually there had been a couple of papers that showed that liquid state machine computing, if you have a fixed topology, works pretty well. But you know, we know in neuroscience that we do not have a fixed topology. We have actually plasticity here, and this plasticity can act actually on the sensitivity of individual neurons. So essentially what this is doing, if a neuron is not active enough, you have mechanism inside that neuron that makes the neuron more sensitive, then the sensitivity increases and the neuron becomes more active. That's one form of plasticity. But another form is also that actually you have plasticity that changes the connection strength between neurons. So it's some kind of embedding of structure in networks, which is of course useful because we may not want to have the network completely random. But of course we have then a self-consistent problem because all these changes that are done either on the neuron level or on the topology of the network will also of course affect the network activity. And many of these plasticity rules are dependent on the network activity. So essentially you have here a self-consistency between network activity and network structure, which is mediated by many different types of plasticity. There are for sure 5 different classes, but they can act actually on very different temporal scales, ranging from milliseconds to actually weeks. And then on top of that, you have information processing, which means you have a bombardment of information that is coming into your brain and changing this activity on top. And if you want to understand now how information processing is occurring, you have to actually study the self-consistent system. So what do? We actually simplify it. We actually just assume 2 different times of plasticity, and they have been carefully selected. You will see why in a moment. And, of course, we decide on a very simple information processing scheme, which is maintenance of information for time series prediction. Okay, so the first causality principle, the first plasticity that we used is the so-called causality principle. So neurons like to actually select neurons, so make actually stronger connection to other neurons if the other neurons drive them. So essentially if A drives B, then actually what the neuron is using is then B should fire after A, and if that really happens, then actually the neuron takes that as an indication that really there is a causal connection between A to B. So essentially, there is a mechanism on the synapse that measures the arrival of information and the production of a spike, and the arrival of a spike is A, and the production of a spike is B, and if that delta T is smaller than 0, then actually this synapse gets strengthened. It's a very complicated biophysical mechanism, but you can actually describe it just like that. If first the presynaptic neuron fires and then the postsynaptic, then this is actually a potentially causal interaction which leads to a potentiation of the coupling strengths. If it's actually the other way around, if first postsynaptic and then presynaptic, then this is an acausal which leads to a depression of that synapse. Very simple. Had been measured experimentally. Here you see the curve. It's like an exponential decay. On the x-axis you have the delta t. Here you are in the domain of strengthening. Here you are in the domain of weakening. And as the distance increases, the impact drops. This is way too complicated for us, so what we do is essentially we just noted that as a binary function for the last step. Okay, so the second type of plasticity that we use is also very important. It's a different type, and this is actually intrinsic plasticity, and this is a homeostatic mechanism. That's actually the sensitivity that I mentioned already. So if actually neurons are in that network and embedded, these neurons do not know to how many other neurons they're going to make contacts, right? So each neuron somehow has to ensure that it's actually going to be active at all, because most of these plasticity forms are only dependent on the exchange of spikes. So if the sensitivity isn't high enough, the neuron cannot learn anything. So therefore, actually, each of these neurons have implemented a sensitivity regulation. If it's too active, sensitivity is downregulated. If it's not active enough, sensitivity is upregulated. And you find that, again, on very different timescales, ranging from milliseconds to days and weeks. So as a mathematical formulation, we just use an update here. We have a threshold, and the threshold is actually increased if we exceeded a certain average activity in time step I. Okay, so these are the two forms. So we have here a form that actually changes the topology of the network, so that it's acting on the links, and intrinsic plasticity is acting actually on the level of individual neurons. So that leaves us with the information processing. Again, we do something very simple. What we do is we have an input time series that is a stream of symbols, and we map these symbols essentially on a topology. So each neuron gets a drive, but how much it actually gets depends on a definition of an input space. So essentially we make a spatial mapping. If A is activated, these four neurons get an additional drive. If B is present, these four neurons get an additional drive. And the drive, of course, is then the parameter that enters the model. Okay. So I would like to actually use that already here to actually tell you what we do with the classification. So let's assume we apply a perturbation here at time step t. We can now actually train this classifier to identify that as b, right? But let's assume we are here at time step b, so t plus 2. So we can actually train the classifier to identify that this dynamical state as b, but of course we also hope, due to the fading memory, that we still have some information present in the system about c, right? The previous time step. So if we train actually the classifier to identify the current activity as c, then we are looking, so to say, one step back in time, right? So we actually we are estimating how much information is still in the system about the last point. But we can also do the two time step backs, and if we have structured the time series, we can also try to predict actually c. Okay, so that's the idea. So essentially, prediction and memory just depends on which symbol you are training actually this classifier. So by the way, if you have a question, you know, ask any time. Okay, so if we want to do predictions, then actually our time series has to have structure, and we decided to use Markov processes of first and second order. Here's an extreme example where we had an extremely high transition probability for a certain sequence of states, which had been A, B, C, D, and you see that has been 0.91, and of course had been much higher than any of the others. So essentially, if you're in B, it's very likely that C is a subsequent state. So we would like to actually have the liquid state machine allow us to predict these states. So here, that's what we get. We have color-coded STDP. That's the learning rule that just learns, that's just based on causality. We have a purely random network with just this intrinsic plasticity, which is homeostatic. And we have the combination of STDP and IP. So what we get is really amazing. So the first thing people predicted, that STDP, that actually learns structure, serves as a very good mechanism for predicting these things. But actually what you see is the performance is 25%. So what it essentially means, you're purely by chance, right? If you have four symbols, you have 25%, you make no prediction. So why is that? Essentially what happens is, the STDP is actually generating an attractor in the dynamics, and the system maintains on the attractor dynamics and is not susceptible to the drive anymore, because the attractor is so deep that actually the drive that comes from outside is not changing the dynamics anymore. So essentially, the system is maintaining its own dynamics without being sensitive to the stimulus. And therefore, liquid state machine idea doesn't work at all. Then actually, let's go to the random network. The random network is actually pretty good. You are able to, with this very simplified system, to predict actually 50% of the states if you apply perturbation. But you can also look like with a decent, like still above chance probability or classification rate 10 steps back. So essentially, you can actually read from the system what happened 10 steps into the past. And for this extremely strong system, you can also predict actually the future pretty well. But now, if you actually use just intrinsic plasticity, you see you already boosted. So why is that? This is also very simple to understand, because if you have a random network and random thresholds, then essentially not all of these neurons participate in the activity. So essentially you have a effectively lower dimensional system than the number of neurons, because some of them are just not being active. If you add intrinsic plasticity, all the neurons actually adapt their threshold such that they become active, and therefore you have this huge phase space, which is really the maximum phase space you can get, and then you get actually good properties for the classification, because you have a high likelihood that you in this high dimensional space get the linear separability. But then actually it was amazing that if you combine the two, the SDP and IP, then you have a very nonlinear behavior. It's not just that you're adding a little bit, but you're boosting it really a lot, right? And then SDP alone doesn't work at all. So it's really the combination of the two that is important. So therefore it's worth spending a second to try to understand what happens. And there are two things. So we just assumed that SDP is good for structure formation, so it's good for sequence learning. But apparently it's so good that it actually learns the average sequence. Of course, the Markov process is not equivalent to the average sequence, and therefore the system sucks. But if you now add intrinsic plasticity, then this on the one hand side serves homeostasis, but it's also doing something else. You can understand the same property as intrinsic noise, and I would like to explain you why. And this actually leads to robustness. So if you have here this state I plus 1 and I plus 2, essentially the system transitions from these different states and would maintain the tractor dynamics. But now what actually happens is intrinsic plasticity acts on these neurons and also on these neurons, but these guys are active very often. These guys are not active, right? Because they are not part of the attractor that is activated here. So essentially what happens, these guys become more sensitive and these guys become less sensitive. So after a while, actually one of these neurons will be actually substituted by one of the other neurons which are in the reservoir. So essentially now the state changed, right? You substitute one neuron. So it's not the same state that is characterized by the attractor, but it's actually different by one neuron. But this guy here stays in the basin of attraction, and STDP learns to associate the new one to the same attractor. And this is because the transition from here to there is strengthened, because you learn by STDP the transitions between the different states. So essentially, what you do is you increase the basin of attraction of all these different neurons, and after a while you really have a competition between the different basin of attractions. And what we showed is essentially, if you let the system run, after a while it actually really, the basin of attraction essentially includes all the states of the four neurons here. But of course, each of the states has a different basin of attraction. So that looks something like that, that over time the trajectories are changing, but they are changing only a little bit. But this is now a model, right? So essentially, from time to time, you substitute neuron by neuron, and then the system learns to associate all these different states to the same dynamics. So if now by chance, due to noise, one of these states is perturbated, the system still classifies the same state to the same class. So the other thing, what we observed was that actually the system self-organizes into a critical state. So of course you know that there are like these different domains like regular activity and chaotic activity. Here we have perfectly predictable states for chaos, we actually have this very nice feature expansion. So essentially, that amplifies differences between states, and therefore actually the classifier has an easier time to distinguish between states. But of course, we know also that we have a loss of predictability in the presence of noise, or if we cannot actually read the history dependence perfectly. Then actually there's a critical state where we actually can combine both. And what we did is, like with the discrete version of the Lapanov exponent, I think I do not have to explain it to you, it's a perturbation analysis. What we found is actually here for SDP and IP, for Markov processes of order 1 and order 2, that actually this system had been pretty much self-organized critical. While STDP, of course, was a very regular behavior, and just by chance, the random network had been chaotic, and intrinsic plasticity had been even more chaotic. So we think that this is another explanation for actually the improved performance, because we combine here the feature expansion and the history dependence. Okay, so I would like to conclude this first part. So the combination of STDP and IP leads to self-organized critical network dynamics, and this intrinsic plasticity acts as noise for increasing error coding robustness.
Are there questions for this first part? Otherwise, I would move on. It's a little bit different topic.
How critical was the K winner takes all assumption, because it means more or less that the activity of the network is restricted to the same level.
Right? So that's essentially a very small part of the entire phase relief. So essentially it turns out not to be very important. So we, in the second step, we got rid of the key winner take all and included what you would do in what you call in neuroscience inhibitory neurons. So essentially that's just a stochastic K, right? And the results have been the same.
Does the IP also help maintaining the same activity level?
Yeah, but IP is actually too slow to really regulate the activity then. So what you have to add in addition is a so-called synaptic rescaling. So you have another form of plasticity that acts on the level of each neuron and weights the different synaptic contributions for each neuron. Right? Then actually you get very stable network dynamics without the imposing such a strong rule.
In the previous picture, please, how do you measure D? Is the network in a self-sustained activity state? I mean, is the activity occurring?
Okay, so what you do is essentially at any moment, and so you let the system run, at any moment in time you apply a certain perturbation. Of course, the perturbation changes the state, and you compare that to the evolution of that state in the next moment. So you compare this distance to this distance, and that is the same as a Lapanov exponent, right? If that number is positive, you essentially have an expansion of the perturbation. If that number is smaller than one, you have a contraction. And this is what you have on the y-axis.
So is it that the self-sustained activity occurs in the network?
But you know, we have to be careful there with self-sustained, because since we have the K-winner take all, it's not very difficult to get self-sustained activity.
Yeah, but if you keep, right? if you don't put any input,
I mean, still you have five neurons active, right?
Okay.
Because you have the K-winner take all. So therefore, self-sustained activity is therefore not defined really for such a system. No, but if you get rid of this fixing of K, then you get self-sustained activity, and you get that stable, this activity, if you have some degree scaling.
But in the case you drop the K when it takes all limitation, did you still end up in a self-organized critical state?
So we just checked it for the SCP and IP, and yes, we do, but a little bit below. So it's more like range between 0.8 and 1.05. It's not, the median is a little bit below the critical. But it's anyway, it's only like 200 parameters if we screen, right? Maybe general statement here. Okay, so I hope that I convinced you that this is a potential way of, you know, doing computations in the brain. So now the question is, can we also measure if we, for example, have real information flow between the very local activity here in the center and maybe the more mesoscopic activity the waves are propagating outside. Or in neuroscience, that would mean, do we have actually a spread of information among, let's say, across the scale of individual neurons and EEG? So how would you do that? You measure things, of course, but then you have to actually come up with a model best to explain what you see, right? So, and I would like to present you one way of doing it, which is a so-called generative model. And for those who are interested actually in the focus project, this is also a part that we're very likely going to use to characterize really interactions in Frankfurt. So let's say you have here like a black box. This is your liquid, or this is like the neuron, or this is the brain, you know. Essentially, you do not know what the thing is doing. In physics, you would say there is some, of course, some update equation, some differential equation, very complicated, very likely, also includes noise. And we have, therefore, a mapping of some input to some output. I picked here a very complicated one concerning statistics because the input is a real valued stimulus, and what we get is a point process. That's actually not simple to do because you cannot assume Gaussian noise and so on. So essentially, you could also actually use a Gaussian process here, but this is just a little bit more complicated, and therefore I selected this. So you have like input and output. Output are just times when things going to happen. So essentially, this is a sequence of times of time points. In neuroscience, there are spikes. Can be any other type of event. Okay, so let's say we have a stimulus that drives this neuron, let's say, or the brain, and we actually measure spikes. Then actually the first thing we also might actually want to use is history dependence. For people that are familiar with the Wiener-Volterra expansion, that is essentially the first order Wiener-Volterra expansion. You essentially make it dependent on the history with some tau. You can also do it with the second order Wiener-Volterra expansion, where you then have two taus, where you have an interaction of tau 1 and tau 2. And then you might also get actually activity from other scales, population activity. Here in a neuronal network, you have activity from all the other neurons, which is population spiking activity, but you also may have just neural mass activity, which characterizes the entire population, which can be measured like LFP or EEG. So you would like to use all these parts to explain how you actually encode something and how actually you generate this output process. So essentially you measure your stimulus, you measure your population activity, and you measure your point process, and you would like to infer this blue box from all the data. So what do you do? You can do a very simple trick. If you want to actually model these point processes, you first make a log model. If you actually want to actually make a Gaussian process, then just forget the log. And then you model essentially a conditional probability. So you model that a certain event happens in time t, and you condition it to some very complicated state epsilon here, or psi of t. And psi is now a composition of different elements, which is a stimulus, a history dependence, a population activity, and a mesoscopic activity. Maybe that's very naive, because it's just a linear model, but we have actually strong tools to test how well we are doing. And I will convince you that this is a very reasonable approach. So essentially what we do is, the log is then exponentiated, so we have a conditional probability, which is e to the power of something, and this something we want to know. So I give you an example. Here we recorded in a monkey 9 trials. Each black dot is a spike, and on the x-axis we have time. So we have no idea what the monkey was seeing. I can tell you it was a moving bar, but we do not know that. And what we want to know is actually the probability that a spike occurs. So what we do know is, we say this linear component here in the exponent is actually a sum of basis functions. These basis functions can be actually highly nonlinear, but we weight each basis function by a linear component, so it's essentially a linear superposition. And here you see some of the basis functions, and that are not any basis functions. This is a so-called cubic spline, which assures us smoothness. So essentially what we do is we take what we're going to find out by the model. We're going to find out here our epsilon.
So essentially that's how much we weight each of these basis functions. Then we sum them up and we get actually something which defines the firing probability. And it looks like that. So if we iterate this, this is a so-called generalized linear model, you get an approximation from the data of the firing probability. One important point is here that we have these red spots, and these red spots are the positions of the knots. And what we essentially did is we derived analytically the most optimal way of putting knots, which is something similar like a Nyquist criteria.
However, so essentially it's like a very simple model for the spiking probability. If you want to know how good you are, you essentially take a new data set and you actually evaluate how well you're predicting spikes with that model in your new data set. And you will see that the performance is actually outstanding. So that's just for an inhomogeneous process, but you can also now use the first Wiener-Volterra approximation. So you add just another term, and this term looks actually L steps back in time. Okay? And what we want to learn is actually this theta L. So you add this here, so you have two terms. And if you want to actually add, for example, neuronal mass activity, you just have some function here of the neuronal mass activity, can be arbitrary, can be very much non-linear, and you again just add here a linear coefficient that is weighting this. One actually function that we use, for example, is the phase and the power. Okay, so this is the prediction of our models. So if you use a very simple moving bar stimulus, so we show that to a monkey, and we record neural net activity. We recorded actually 251 cells in 4,060 models. And then actually we used the GLM, so the one that actually includes the first order approximation of the Wiener-Volterra expansion, and we found that we can actually predict in a new data set, a data set that we haven't used for actually the training, 90.6% of the spikes. So it's extremely powerful, this tool. If we go to a natural movie, then we expect actually the task is much more difficult. Why? Imagine that you have a recurrent network here, and that single neurons are activated at a certain spot, let's say here. So essentially, if the moving bar is on top of that neuron is going to be activated, but none of the other neurons is going to be activated. So you have a very simple dynamics of the entire system because you have hardly any recurrent system. You activate single neurons one after the other. In a natural movie, that's completely different, right? So you have all the neurons being active at all the times, they exchange information, delay coupling, so it's a complete mess. So we expect this to be a much more difficult system, and what we find, we can only predict 58% of the data perfectly.
So what is a cell? Is it a neural cell? Or
it's a neuron. Eye?
It's the eye and the...
It's a visual cortex, V1.
Randomly picked from the visual cortex.
Randomly picked. And the task is to predict the activity of that neuron without knowing the stimulus. Okay? Okay, so the question is, why is it actually so much worse? So maybe we can actually boost this if we consider the activity of all the other neurons. So that's what we do. We actually include here activity from the LFP. And what we try different measures. For example, we try power and phase for different timescales. So how do we extract timescales? We have a signal, and then we do a Debussy decomposition into different timescales. And we have here, in that case, we have 7 timescales that give us orthogonal basis functions. And then we can, for example, just use the power of that signal. Or we can actually use just the phase, or we can actually use both. So here you might wonder, that's actually not a linear function anymore, because we have actually the phase inside the cosine. That's a trouble for actually our linear model. It's not, you can actually rewrite this as cosine of phi 0 plus sinus with 2 different coefficients, right? So you just actually rewrite it as a linear function. So then we find if we add power, then actually we have no increase of the performance. If we add phase, we have 28% increase of the performance. And if we add both again, we have again 28%. So this is a very solid basis to say it's just the power, just the phase of our LFP. So it's a mesoscopic like EEG activity that boosts the signal.
Is that related with a coherence perception? Or a time cone effect? Or?
Yeah, you will see on the next slide. So here you see actually, here you see how that is modulated. Since we actually, that's a really strong point, since we made a model to predict spikes, we can now actually go back and actually ask, what is the feature that really actually makes a difference if we include LFP? So in a way, we actually were modeling the transfer function, right? So we really have an explicit model of the transfer function now. So here's a green thing. That is what we would expect if we would think we have just a rate code, inhomogeneous Poisson process. We have here three different trials. And you see, of course, it would be very much the same. But here, you see the green curve, and the green curve is the modulation that we get if we add actually the phase of the signal. And then we have the white spots that are the real spikes. And the first thing you see is that spikes are perfectly aligned here with peaks. Right? Very, very well aligned. So what you can do now is you can actually look for the prototype function that is surrounding a spike, and that looks like this. And here we had actually 258 cells, not all are plotted. It's actually every fifth cell that is plotted because of just the density of lines. But you see that actually pretty much all these cells behave very similar. So what happens here is that the neuron fires here, and this here is the surrounding mesoscopic mass activity. And you see that actually the mesoscopic activity from the entire population is very tightly locked or correlated with this shape to the spike that the neuron is producing. And therefore you have coherence, right? Because you could now generalize these 258 cells have been picked randomly, right? If that is the case for each randomly picked cell, then actually each of these cells should have the same shape and therefore they should be coherent.
I have some
on average, not for each one in time, right?
I think I'm losing more and more.
Yeah.
So this is the blue line is.
That's the neuronal mass activity.
What is the neuronal mass activity?
That is, for example, something which we call local peak potential, but it's just a local, EEG.
So this means that every neuron goes in its activity over the shape, or that the 256 or 8 together, they should form this this time picture.
Okay, so do you see each of these grays here, these gray lines? Each of these gray lines corresponds to a single neuron.
Okay.
The blue one is the average.
Yes.
Okay. But what you see is that pretty much for all these individual neurons, you have the same shape. It's not identical, of course, but you have pretty much a similar shape.
Okay.
So what that means is if we see that shape, that's the average shape, in the local field potential, which is the green thing. Okay? The green thing is something like the local field potential. Okay? Then you find actually that the neuron fires like 4 milliseconds ahead of this characteristic feature. So essentially that means nothing else. Whenever you find a feature like that, you have an increased likelihood that the neuron fired 4 milliseconds ahead of the peak of that feature. So you decoded your local peak potential such that you now know a characteristic feature which makes each of the individual neurons fire more likely. Doesn't mean that this is causal, right? It could also be that actually the neurons, which are then coherent, cause this feature on the mesoscopic scale. Did I clarify your question?
You gave more, but there's also a question, but I said yes, but that
could okay, be. But that's the last slide for data, so I conclude, so there's actually more room for answers for questions. So essentially what we actually did, so we can identify with such an approach, with such a very linear, extremely linear model, but actually remember actually the basis function that we needed, that we used had been nonlinear. So we can identify and characterize components of neuronal encoding functions on different scales, including spiking activity and neuronal mass activity. For more complex stimuli like natural movies, neuronal mass activity is a major component of the neuronal encoding. And that can be as important as the stimulus. So I would like to show that again here. So you see the modulation of the firing probability is at least of the same order as
the from trial to trial by the stimulus induced like that, right? So essentially the neural mass activity is extremely important for the modulation of spiking of individual neurons. Different scales contribute differently. So this essentially suggests that neuronal processing is based on multi-scale activity. And that, of course, then means that we really have to consider this multi-scale activity if we want to decode the brain. So multi-scale encoding and decoding models can reveal principal information for PCI, which is a brain-computer interface, essentially, for individual scales. And with that, actually, I would like, actually, the people that are working with me, of course, you see many faces that you know. The ones that you might not know, this is Sergio Neuenschwander, who recorded with Bruce together the data. Wolf Singer, who is the director at the Max-Planck Institute. Jochen Triesch and Andrea Lazar are my colleagues that are working on the liquid state machines. Raul, you know, and then we have Emery Brown and Sedge, who are my colleagues from MIT.
Well, we had already some questions, but we have time for more questions. For example, I have one very destructive question. What would need to be the nature of a dynamical process of a system that this multi-scale encoding model fails? So do you have some knowledge about what are the limitations of this approach?
So as soon as you have no link between the dynamics of the two scales, the system will essentially tell you that you do not gain information from using the other scales. But this also tells you something, right? I mean, it tells you essentially that either your model sucks because you haven't included the right extraction of features, or it says there's no link between the two. Honestly, I think in neuroscience, in such a complex system, we always have a spread of information across scales, and it's very likely that if you see no information, no informative contribution, that this is due to the wrong model or insufficient model.
Are there more questions? If not, God will still be here until tomorrow afternoon, and there will be possibilities to further discuss these things with him. Okay, thank you very much.
Grazie.